morning all of you. We will continue with the history chapter, the age of industrialization, and today we will have a look at when factories came up in India. So we'll have a look at who were the people who set up these industries and where did the money came in for setting up these industries. Then who were the people who came to work in these factories and mills. So we will have a look at all that today. Now the first cotton mill in Bombay, it came up in 1854 and then it started working 2 years later. Then by 1862, four mills, they started work with 94,000 spindles and 2,150 looms. And around the same time as this, like 1860s, some jute mills also came up in Bengal, and the first being set up in 1855, and another one came up 7 years later. Then in North India, if we talk about North India, so the Eglin mill, it was started in Kanpur in the 1860s, and a year later the first cotton mill of Ahmedabad, it was also set up. And by 1874, the first spinning and weaving mill of Madras, it also began production. So these were the first few industries which came up in India. Now these industries, they were set up in so many regions, so they were set up in different regions by different sorts of people. And let us see who these people were who set up these first industries or these first mills in India. Now the history of business groups in India, now it goes back to trade with China. And now what happened in the 18th century, the British, they were here in India and they began to export opium from India to China, and then from China they took tea to England. So basically, Europeans, they wanted tea. So they had to take this tea from China, but if you do not give something in return, that is the barter system, so they'll have to pay money. They did not want it to pay in gold and all that, and so what they did, they started importing opium to China from India, because obviously India was under their control. So they started to import opium, export opium from India to China, and then from China they took tea and took it to Europe, all right, to England. And now many Indians, they became like junior players, means they were not the ones who controlled everything, this whole network of trade. They did not control it, but they began working in some of the things, like some provided finance, some provided money, loans, and some procured supplies, means they obtained supplies, they took supplies, some shipped the supplies. And so these people who were involved in this China trade, they made a lot of money through trade. And now some of these people who have made a lot of money through this China trade, they had dreams that they will set up their industrial enterprises or their industrial companies or businesses in India. Now in Bengal, Dwarkanath Tagore, he has also made a lot of money in China trade, and then he turned to invest money in industries, and he set up six joint stock companies in the 1830s and 1840s. Joint stock, can you tell me what you understand by this joint stock companies? Anyone here? I think many of you are smart enough to know or have any idea about it. Yes, beta.
Connected different ma'am, different companies connected from companies.
No, we are talking about like one company having joint stock, means the shares are owned by different people, not one people has the entire control. Shares and all, you must have heard about.
Yes, shares. Ma'am. Yes,
so,
ma'am.
Basically a joint stock company is a company which is owned by its different shareholders or stakeholders. It is not controlled by just one person. It is not just owned by one person. So he set up six joint
ma'am,
companies.
Now almost.
Yes, beta.
Ma'am, now almost all the companies are joint
yeah,
stock.
Right. And he set up these six joint stock companies in the 1830s and 1840s. But because at that time, 1840s, we had an international business crisis. The economy was down. It was because of something which happened in the US. And so, people were afraid that... means now they will lose their money, so they started taking out their money from the market, and there was so much fear in the market, and now that spread throughout the world, and there was inflation, there was rise in prices, jobs were less, people did not have jobs and all, and so companies, they sank, and many of the others enterprises, they also sank in this business crisis of the 1840s. But many people who later on they invested money, they became successful industrialists. So in Bombay we have Parsis like Dinsho Petit and Jamshedji Nusarwanji Tata, and these people, they had built huge industrial empires in India, and these people, they had made their wealth, their money from exports to China. So mostly they have made their money from these exports to China, and also partly from raw cotton shipments to England. Now if you remember the last time we met, we talked about some of the problems which the weavers faced in the 19th century. And so if you remember that, one problem was that the weavers, they started having a new problem that they could not get sufficient supply of raw cotton. Because, when the American Civil War, it broke out, so the cotton supplies from US to Britain, they were cut off. And so, then what happened? Britain, they turned to India. And so, raw cotton exports from India, they increased, and the prices of raw cotton shot up. So, these people, they have also made money through China trade and also through this raw cotton shipments to Britain. So, they have made money there. And then Seth Hukum Chand, he was a Marwari businessman, and he set up the first Indian jute mill in Calcutta in 1970. And he also had trade links with China. So, he also traded with China. So, he also made a lot of money there, and so did so many of industrialists at that time, and also the father as well as the grandfather of the famous industrialist J.D. Birla. So these people also, they had made a lot of money through China trade and also through this raw cotton shipments. Mostly they have made money through China trade, and some have also made money through this raw cotton shipments to England or to Britain. Then these were not only the two sources through which the people, they have made money, but capital, it was also accumulated, it was also got through other trade networks. Now some merchants from Madras, they had their links with Burma, and while other had links with the Middle East and East Africa. So these people, they also made money. Then there were certain other groups, and these groups were not directly involved in international trade, all right? And but they operated within India, and they carried goods from one place to another. Some banked money, means they gave loans, and then obviously with interest they took it back. Some transferred funds from one city to another, and gave loans to finance to traders also. And so these people also, through these trade and all, internal trade, they have also made a lot of money. And when opportunities for investment came, so many of them set up their own factories. But though they set up their factories and mills, but they did not have much freedom to work as they wished, because the colonial control, the British control over Indian trade, it tightened. Because when they realized that these people are also making, setting up their industries, and so they will lose. reduce their profit, and so you know they tightened their grip over Indian trade, and the freedom within which you know the Indian merchants could function, it became very less. It became increasingly limited, so it became very less. And first what happens, the Indians, they were barred, means they were stopped. They could not trade with Europe in manufactured goods, means they could only trade in raw materials. They could not trade in produced manufactured goods, and they only had to export raw materials and food grains, basically, you know, raw cotton, opium, wheat and indigo. Why? Because these were required by the British. And then they could not sell, they could not trade in manufactured goods, they could only export raw materials and food grains. And then, you know, gradually they were also edged out, means they were also removed, the Indians were also removed from the shipping business. Now, till the First World War, the European managing agencies, they controlled a large part of Indian industries. And now three of the biggest these European managing agencies were the Bird, Hyglers and Company, Andrew Yule, and the Jardine, Skinner and Company. Now, what these agencies did, they organized capital, they organized money, and they set up joint stock companies, and they managed them. So, all this was managed by the European managing agencies. And in most of the instances, what happened, instances, the Indian financiers, basically, they provided the capital, means they provided money or the infrastructure, whereas the European agencies, they made investment and they took all the business decisions. And then these European merchant industrialists, you know, they had their own chambers of commerce, they had their own deliberating body, where like councils and all, and where they hold discussions and debates and all that. And but Indian businessmen, they were not allowed to join their chambers. Okay, so we got to know that who, from where they got the money, and who were these first industrialists who set up their factories and mills in India. Now, so factories and mills established, now we need workers to work in them. So, where did the workers come from? Now, with the expansion of factories, now the demand of workers, it increased, and in 1901, there were 584,000 workers in Indian factories, but by 1946 this number has increased to over 24,36,000. Now, from where did so many workers came from? Now, in most regions where we had factories and mills, workers, they normally came from the districts around it. And you know, peasants means farmers and artisans, local skilled workers who could not find any job in village, you know, they came to these industrial centers in search of jobs, in search of work. And like in Bombay cotton industry in 1911, over 50% of the workers, they came from the neighboring district of Ratnagiri, whereas in the mills of Kanpur, most of the people who were working there, they were from the district within the district of Kanpur. And so most often what these workers did, you know, they moved between villages and city, and whenever, you know, there was a harvest or there were festivals, they used to go back to their villages and then again came back to work in these factories and mills. Now, with time, you know, the news spread that factories and mills are coming up, and there are employment opportunities. And so, you know, workers, earlier they used to work only in the neighboring part, but now when the news of employment, it got around, so workers, they even traveled great distances in the hope of getting work in these mills and factories. And so from the United Provinces, any idea which were the United Provinces? What do we call as United Provinces? No? Okay, the provinces of Agra and Awadh, they were called as the United Provinces. And later on, you know, after independence, the name was changed. And you know, even today we are UP, Uttar Pradesh, though the name has been changed. But at that time, the provinces of Agra and Awadh, they were together, combined, they were called as the United Provinces. So, you know, from here, north, you know, people, they went to work in the textile mills of Bombay and even to work in the jute mills of Calcutta. So earlier, you know, people from the nearby areas, they only worked, but later on when news spread, so people, they even traveled great distances to find work in these factories and mills. Now, so news spread around and, you know, there were new factories and mills coming up. But, you know, getting job was always a difficult task. Why? Because, you know, the number who's looked for job, they were always more than the number of jobs which were available. So even when factories and mills, they multiplied, and even the number of workers that they wanted, the demand for number of workers, it increased. But still, you know, the case was always that the number seeking work was always more than the number of jobs available. So now entry into the mills, you know, it was restricted. It was not that anyone could get a job in the factories and the mills. And so industrialists, what they did, you know, they employed a jobber. So an official who was called as a jobber, and his work was to get new recruits, means his problem was to get people to jobs. And now very often, who this jobber was, you get straight question on jobber. So this jobber was normally an old and trusted worker. So, you know, factories and mills, whoever they had as a very old and trusted worker, they would entrust him with this job. So he was called a jobber, and he got people from his village, gave them jobs, then helped them to settle in the city. And whenever there was a crisis, he helped them with money also. And so, you know, with time, the jobber, he became a person of authority and power, and he began to control the life of the workers. He began demanding money and gifts for his favor. And the number of factory workers, it increased over time, means with time, the number of factory workers, it increased. But as you will see, and as we have also seen in the case of Britain, that a very, you know, these a very small proportion of these workers worked in industrial workforce, but the majority of the people, they were still working in their own domestic units. All right, so have you understood till here? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
What about the rest?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so let's continue. Page 120, my book, the page number is different. So the peculiarities of industrial growth. We have already seen that the European managing agencies, you know, they dominated the industrial production in India, and they were interested only in certain kinds of products. And so what they did, they established tea and coffee plantations here in India. They got land at cheap rates from the colonial government. Their government was here only, so they got land for establishing tea and coffee plantations at cheap rates. And then they also invested in mining indigo and jute. And why? Because, you know, most of these products, they were required for export. They were not for sale in India. Now they were interested in them because these were in great demand in Europe. So they wanted to export these things to Europe, and these were not for sale in India. Now, when Indian businessmen, they began to set up their own industries in the late 19th century, you know, they did not wanted to have any competition with Manchester goods in the Indian market, because, you know, Manchester goods, they were made with machines, uniform goods, and they sold at cheap prices. So, you know, they did not wanted to compete with that. And since yarn means thread, it was not a important part of British imports into India. Means Britishers were not importing yarn. They were not importing yarn. They were not importing thread into India. And so the early cotton mills in India, they started to produce coarse cotton yarn. Means coarse cotton thread. They did not produce fabric. They did not produce cloth. They produced only thread yarn. Because, and why they produced coarse yarn, because, you know, even when yarn was imported into India, it was of finer or superior quality. And so they did not wanted any competition, so they started to make this coarse or rough thread. And now this yarn, which was produced in the Indian spinning mills, it was used by handloom workers in India, or it was exported to China. But by the first decade of the 20th century, again, you know, there were series of changes, and this also affected industrialization. Let's see what happened during this time. Now, as the during this time, Swadeshi movement gathered momentum. Swadeshi boycott movement. Yes, it is related to
civil disobedience.
Civil disobedience. Anyone else?
No, ma'am. Non-cooperation movement.
Yes, ma'am. Non-cooperation.
You know, there was some incident which led to two new methods of protest. Something happened. Lord Curzon is involved in that. Lord Curzon was involved in that. What was that?
Ma'am, the taxation.
The partition of Bengal.
1905,
yes. Remember the partition of Bengal in 1905, you know, it led to two new methods of protest, Swadeshi and boycott. From there it started. Okay, so now as the Swadeshi movement, you know, it gathered momentum, it gathered pace, speed. So nationalists, you know, they got together people, they mobilized people, and they asked them to boycott foreign cloth. And so that was one thing. And then, you know, industrial groups in India, the Indian industrialist group, they got together and they wanted to protect their interests. And so they pressurized the British government to increase tariff protection. Tariff protection means they wanted the British government to increase duty or taxes on imports, so that they want to protect. Now, why they wanted to increase this taxes on imports? They wanted to basically protect the domestic firms from you know, import competition, because if things would be imported, they will be here in the local market and they'll have to compete it with that. So what they wanted, an increase in tariff so that the number of imports would be less in India. They also asked for some other concessions. So one thing, Swadeshi movement, it gained momentum. Then the industrialist groups, they also organized themselves. And then from 1906, the export which India was doing to China, it declined. Earlier, you know, this rough yarn which Indian mills were producing, it was used by the handloom weavers in India, and it was exported to China. But now, from 1906, the export of Indian yarn to China, it declined. Why? Because Chinese and Japanese mills, they also started production, and so you know, they flooded the Chinese market, and so now they were not taking these things from India. So now industrialists, what they did, they began shifting from yarn, they began shifting from thread to cloth production. And cotton piece goods, they started to be produced in India, and they doubled between 1900 and 1912. So though, you know, now they started to produce cotton goods also, means cotton cloth also, but still till the First World War, industrial growth was slow. First World War, period of First World War. Till the First World War, the industrial growth, it was slow. But this First World War, it created a new situation. What happened, you know, because the World War was on, and Britain, you know, we obviously know they were involved in that. Now the British mills, they were busy with the war production, and they wanted to meet the needs of the army. So there, the Manchester factories and all, you know, they started producing these war needs. And so whatever imports we were getting into India from Manchester, it declined. And now the Indian mills, you know, they had such a huge market to cater to supply. And then, you know, war, it prolonged, it went on. And then even, you know, the Britishers, they asked the Indian factories also to supply things for war, like jute bags, cloth for army uniforms, tents, leather boots, horses and mule saddles, and so many other items. And so as a result, new factories were set up and old ones, they had to work multiple shifts. So many new workers, they were employed and everyone was made to work for longer hours. And over the time, the war went on, industrial production in India, it literally boomed. But after the war, Manchester, you know, it could never recapture its old position in the Indian market because they were now unable to modernize and compete with the US, Germany and Japan. So the economy of Britain, it crumbled after the war, and cotton production, it collapsed, and export of cotton cloth from Britain, it fell dramatically. And within the colonies, what happened? Local industrialists, like if we talk about India, so the local industrialists, you know, gradually they strengthened their position, and they substituted the foreign manufacturers and started to, you know, sell their things in that place, and they started to capture the home market. Okay, so for today we will stop here. Have you all understood what we have done till now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, what about the rest?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.